Hello, I'm Jack Rickard, and this is what's left of an older and slower EVTV. It's been a month. We're going to jump right in and talk about artificial intelligence and autopilot. I have to tell you, I've been a skeptic. They introduced autopilot on the Tesla Model S. Immediately killed a couple of guys and caused a couple of other wrecks. And I had several objections to it. The first being a legal transition, in that in America, if you have a car wreck, it is assumed that the driver made the error. Human error is 98% of all the vehicle accidents we have in this country, taking some 35,000 lives per year. And while there are mechanical problems, those can usually be attributed to poor maintenance practices by the vehicle owner. Once in a blue moon, we have a big, very public lawsuit against an automotive manufacturer. It's never really about a hardware failure. It's about a design flaw or hardware failure where they knew about it, passed memos back and forth for years about it, and decided that if only 70 or 80 people were killed, that they wouldn't spend the $12 to fix it. And in every case where that's gotten into a courtroom, it's resulted in at least $100 million worth of haircut. So you would think the automotive manufacturers would be very leery of the courtroom. In introducing autopilot, the manufacturer kind of assumes some responsibility for the operation of the car and some legal obligation and exposure in the event of the almost inevitable incidents. Elon Musk has been particularly aggressive in promoting autopilot and autonomous driving, which I find a little bit strange given his further views on artificial intelligence. But I would take it all more seriously except for the fact that I own and occasionally, given the very nice nature of my wife, that she lets me drive it occasionally. And it has some very interesting features. For example, it will automatically open and close my garage door. About 3 out of 4 times when I come home, it'll open the garage door. And on the fourth, it mystically just doesn't. About 50% of the time, when I leave, it will close the door behind me. The other half of the time, it simply doesn't. But it does occasionally if I pull up into the driveway and run into the house to get something. Then when I depart, it opens the garage door instead of closing it because it was already closed. And I return home hours later to find that my garage door has been open all that time. I'm not the slightest bit frustrated with this. It provides almost an endless and ongoing regular dose of comedy into my driving life, and I actually enjoy it. Even better is the radio. Did you know that the Tesla now has a fascinating new feature where you can press a button and simply expose your desires verbally to the universe as to what you would like to hear on the radio? And their software is so cunning, it will go out on the internet and fetch a song for you and play it. About 25 to 30% of the time, it's the title you requested, and about 4 to 5% of the time, it's the artist you wanted. It's, again, high comedy. I can't wait to get in the car and give it a title and see what this idiotic machine is going to come up with to play next. It's actually a lot of fun. Given that, the prospects of it driving me down the highway unattended are somewhat alarming. Learn to open the garage door first, Elon, and maybe play a song on the radio, and I'll take your autonomous driving more seriously. There's a couple of things that have caused me to re-examine this issue. One of them is an intense churn of employees at Tesla. I don't even know if I can get this straight, but David Nister was the head of computer vision, and he hired Berta Rodriguez Hervez to be part of that. Earlier this year, Nister left to go to NVIDIA, and now Rodriguez Hervez has gone with him. Minwoo Park, head of the visual perception team, and Yakun Jeong, head of the geometric vision team, both left this month. About 6 months ago, Chris Lattner, creator of the Swift programming language at Apple, came over to Tesla to lead the autopilot hardware team. After 6 months, he has left, and he and Tesla both allow as how it wasn't a good match. And he didn't leave to go anywhere. He's looking for exciting new opportunities as we speak. The latest hire is Andrej Karpathy. Dr. Andrej Karpathy has a PhD in computer vision from Stanford, and he is now AI and autopilot vision head under Jim Keller, the new head of autopilot hardware and software. I've seen more stable relationships among teams at a Pike beer bust at the university. This is like a race riot under the influence of bathtub gin. People are coming and going in all directions. Why would that be? I'm just guessing a couple of things. One is that Elon Musk's design goals and milestones are probably a bit daunting to anyone with experience in computer vision, artificial intelligence, and autonomous vehicles. The second aspect, and perhaps the alternate element, is simply that everybody in the industry is trying to hire people to chase this dream of autonomous driving. But this week, I read a very well put together and well thought through essay by a gentleman at Intel mapping out their vision of autonomous vision and autonomous driving for the future, and I found it very persuasive. For one thing, they believe that this will cause a $7.5 trillion disruption in America's economy. And when you stop and think about all the people that make a living driving trucks and taxi cabs, delivery vehicles, and so forth, I'll buy that. I think that may even be conservative. The ability to send cars hither and yon without a driver to places where you want them spotted at for whatever purposes is indeed alluring. But I have said for three decades now that the evolution of technology is not so much the evolution of what is possible or the dependence on earlier infrastructures, which it appears to be. It's almost in all cases a function of human desire. And more recently, I've actually come to believe that a great deal of our reality is actually formed by the human minds acting in concert. And so if there's sufficient focused intent on the very real and daunting problems of autonomous driving, understand whatever you program, there's going to be a variation on it down in the next block, down in the next mile, and at the next right-hand turn you make. The one gentleman that was decapitated while watching Harry Potter down in Florida, a white truck pulled out against a white sky, and the car missed it. And so at 70 miles an hour, he plowed through the truck or underneath it, removing the erstwhile movie viewer of his upper appendage. And you're going to find this. I lived in Colorado for 20 years. You have glare ice. You have intense fog. You have snow some days in the sun so blinding, you'll get a sunburn on your face and you can't see without welder's glasses on to drive the car, not sunglasses. It's so bright. Sitting in your car, you'll get a sunburn on your face from the sun reflecting off the snow. And in the gloom of night in Montrose Pass in the fog, they've piled up as many as 200 cars who simply couldn't stop on the ice in time to avoid the pileup. It wound up being a huge party, several hundred people all sitting around and clapping as the next car plowed into the pile. So the environment that an automobile operates in is extremely varied, but the desire to have autonomous driving is very real. Most importantly, the concept of artificial intelligence itself has reached a cusp, a precipice, a new inflection point, and that is the term artificial intelligence is too vague. Machine learning, I prefer, and that is the ability for a machine to act outside of the coded algorithms and do its own programming. In other words, to be able to learn how to respond to different stimuli without programmed instruction. And we seem to have machines at this point that can do it. Most recently, an artificial intelligence machine destroyed the top player of the Japanese game Go, which was not even viewed as something that could be encoded in artificial intelligence. And Google has just done a simulation with an artificial intelligence engine where it was instructed on how to move its limbs and motivated to travel through a simulated virtual environment maze, but not told how to walk. And it actually learned to walk, and they can view this and see it moving its legs and its arms. And some of it's comical, but all of it seems to be pretty effective. And so when you have a machine with almost infinite speed and almost infinite memory and the ability to learn on its own, you have kind of a new organism. Were you to connect that to an internetwork of networks worldwide and give it access to all the information that was out there, I understand Elon Musk's deep concern about the future of AI. And I view his proposed solution of governmental regulation as hopelessly naive. This is extremely dangerous to our future, our economy, and our very life. I find it ironic that Elon's real mission in space is not so much to colonize Mars as it is to build a satellite network and basically seize control of the internet, which will be a very high profit item for him if he can deliver gigabit internet to your cell phone anywhere on the planet. And ironically, he calls this Skynet. Skynet, if you will recall, is the artificial intelligence network in the film The Terminator with Arnold Schwarzenegger, where it became self-aware and launched World War III to destroy humanoids. And so that sounds preposterously unlikely, except we're almost to the point of putting all the tools together to do just that. I think it is alarming. But I do believe that the autonomous driving is going to come to pass simply because a lot of smart people really want it to come to pass. And a lot of corporations are simply paying outrageous bonuses and salaries, moving the those gifted with experience and intellect in this area from one company to another in a rapid-fire game of musical chairs. And I don't know where all that ends. But somebody is going to lead the way into autonomous driving. My bet would be Elon Musk. And for those of you who have followed EVTV in the past, and some of you have profited thereby, without giving any stock advice, I would advise that I have personally invested somewhat seriously in Tesla again for the fourth or fifth time this past week at a historically rather high price. This month they do roll out to the first 30 customers on July 28th the new Model 3. The Model 3 represents a number of things, but one particular to me in that they intend to be making 20,000 units a month by December and 500,000 a year by the year 2019. And all that is challenging, but probably nearly doable. And if they fall short, it won't mean much. When we started EVTV, there were no OEM cars available for purchase with electric drive. The Tesla Roadster was announced. It was touted, but it was unobtainium in May of 2009 when we did our first video. In the interim, we have tried to inspire a number of people to build and show electric cars to alter the public perception of electric drive electric cars. And at the point where Tesla has 400,000 deposits on the Model 3, the stock is down a bit. I think there's some talk of missed deliveries in the second quarter and so forth. The truth is they're going to suffer some cannibalization of their Model X and Model S sales as the less expensive Model 3 becomes available. And that's somewhat inevitable. But I don't think it alters the future for the company very much. They will continue to sell Model S's and Model X's, which are both great cars and have a following. A whole new band of customers is enabled by the lower price of the Model 3, and people that were kind of in between are probably going to drop to the Model 3 rather than biting the bullet and buying the higher price Model S or X. Given the blue sky in the automotive industry, Tesla is now dominant. The other OEMs are simply whistling in the dark. VW announced this week that they could kill Tesla because they simply had capabilities that Tesla didn't have. So far in the history of EVTV, they've had the profound capability of issuing more press releases about electric vehicles than any other single entity on the planet without ever actually delivering any. The rest of the automotive market is playing catch-up, and Tesla is starting from a position of less than 0.5% market share with nothing, no place to go but up, and demonstrated heavy execution with cars they've already delivered, people have driven and reviewed, and the vote is in. And so I rate Tesla a buy on the cars. I also rate them a buy on the solar, and more about that in a minute. There are some negative things going on about Tesla. I told you so, that this thing about turning off the cars when they were wrecked so you could not repair them without going to a Tesla service center. And that's exacerbated. We had a visit by a gentleman from Kansas City who had submitted 4 different claims to the insurance company for hail damage to this very light aluminum body, that every time you get in a hailstorm, it was another $14,000 or $15,000, or in one case $18,000. And he was on his 4th incident. And now, I said we were going to wind up with a car that was simply uninsurable. It's come to pass. An Insurance Institute for Highway Safety and Highway Loss Data Institute has once again confirmed that the Tesla Model S electric car is an outlier. It got very high ratings for its crash safety, but in comparing it with their gasoline-powered cars, the Model S's claim insurance claim frequency is 36.9% higher. Claim severity also rises as well. The severity is 63.5% greater than all other cars. And finally, the total losses far exceeded the average vehicle, with overall damage for the Model S being 123.9% higher than the average loss on a vehicle. And we've known about this for some time, because you can take a brand new Tesla with 5,000 miles, wreck it. It's not readily repairable unless you want to spend $60,000 or $70,000 or $80,000 doing so. And so the insurance companies routinely total it and put it on the salvage market. The problem with that is nobody knows what to do with it. There is kind of a base value of $30,000 to $40,000 in it from people like me buying the wrecks and taking out the drive units, or increasingly the batteries for both cars and for solar installations, which I think is the ideal application of them. And so I believe will be a key part of the future of solar. But the Tesla insurance data will soon be followed by, of course, the insurance rates. And my Tesla brand new was $1,200 a year for full coverage for me and my wife. We're 60 years old, haven't had accidents in half a century, and I typically get insurance on any car for $100 every 6 months. The Tesla was admittedly an expensive car, so it was $1,200. I think you could easily be looking at $6,000 to $9,000 a year to insure a Tesla over the next 2 years. And that's going to dramatically change the game there. Speaking of game changers, let me see if I can find the beginning of this. We've had a Supreme Court case, which apparently has nothing to do with us, but it has everything to do with us. And it goes to right to repair and a lot of what we do at EVTV. The Supreme Court case, Impression Products, Inc. versus Lexmark International, the court ruled that a company that sells you something cannot use its patent on that product to determine or influence how you use it after you buy it. In other words, simply because they have a patent on it and sell it to you doesn't mean that they can generate a lot of fine print restricting your usage of the product after you have bought and paid for it. It is yours. And the case in point was Lexmark and their printer toner cartridges. And they sold them two ways in theory. In practice, of course, not. The one way was at a huge discount, 50% or so, if you agreed to only return it to them or destroy it and not to give it to anybody else. And the second way was full price, which no person, humanoid, that we know of ever took advantage of that mode. But a lot of people did try to get them refilled, and in fact, there were a number of companies that made a pretty good chunk of change taking those cartridges. They reverse engineered the little chip in there that purportedly prevented you from reusing it, and then refilled it with toner for a fraction of the cost of what Lexmark was tagging you for. And one of them was Impression Products. A number of other companies were threatened with legal action. A number of larger companies settled the case, often by paying Lexmark and ceasing operation of this toner cartridges, restricting your ability to buy cheaper toner cartridges instead of from Lexmark. But Impression Products, a little bitty company, for some reason, probably run by a Jack Rickard type, got their back up and just wouldn't cave. And they fought it all the way to the Supreme Court, mostly losing at each step along the way, till it got to the Supreme Court, who ruled that you really don't have any rights to the product after you sell it. The patent is intended to protect you from other people making and selling the same thing against you for a certain amount of time. Once you have sold it, your rights are considered to be satisfied, and the person who gets it can do anything they want to with it other than manufacture them and sell them against you. It's kind of like copyright. This goes very much to the concept of the intellectual property and the restrictions on the cars, including Tesla's habit of turning the car off over GSM once it's wrecked, so the new owner or the old owner cannot repair it and operate it without permission from Tesla, and that usually means paying Tesla that repair fee. And so it leaves them a little bit stranded on that whole concept, and it's rather dubious. There's also a propensity for some of these companies, General Motors, John Deere, and in some cases Tesla, in threatening people who were doing things with their hardware or software that they didn't want done. And the teeth have been pulled on that. As I have, the Supreme Court seems to agree with me, once you buy it, you own both halves. And you can do anything you want to with it. That's pretty much it on the cars. I would say that I kind of glossed over it, but the other sort of meaning for EVTV with the introduction of the Model 3 is largely our work is done here. We existed to promote electric vehicles and to get the ball rolling, and I'm willing to declare victory. Now you can surmise what you will, what would have happened with or without me, and I really don't care, but our mission is coming to an end as far as the furtherance of electric cars. It needs no furtherance. I believe we are at the point where electric vehicles are going to be adopted. It's safely done. I would say Elon Musk has single-handedly had the largest role in that. But with the advent of the Model 3, the conclusion is no longer in doubt. And there is no one in any automaker who does not get this message and are not terrified by it. This week, the oil companies have announced that their projections of the number of electric cars in the future have been revised upwards by a factor of five. This is a particularly strange reaction to me. We pretty much declared war on the oil companies in 2008. They didn't seem to notice, and they didn't show up for the war. And so we've had unfettered, really, 9 years since then, with them entirely asleep at the switch while the electric car has evolved and matured. And at this point, I believe they're ready for the rest of us and the non-technical person to own and operate successfully, to drive it across country successfully, which I've never felt was a critical need in an electric vehicle, and I still don't. But if you can do it, that's a plus. But at this point, the advantages of electric cars become apparent to pretty much everyone, and it gets to be a function of price. And as our regular viewers know, I'm unimpressed by price, impressed by value proposition as a predictor of any individual company's survival. But in the long run, the prices are all craven and jello as we enter the adoption curve, and we are just about at the point of beginning the early adoption phase. This is the close of the tinker and innovator stage and the beginning of the early adopter phase, at which point we can look forward to, within 2 to 3 years, to a vertical climb in the numbers and a precipitous decline in the costs. Coming out the other side of that, I think you'll find that even with the batteries, electric cars are simpler, have a dramatically reduced parts count from a conventional powered vehicle, and inevitably will wind up being less expensive than a gasoline car by a considerable amount. This is truly a disruptive technology. In its infancy, it had some problems, but the infancy is over. We're going to continue doing some builds and some things here at EVTV. Of course, I'm captivated by the reverse engineering of the Tesla Model S drive unit and the batteries. But I think you'll see that not so much is going to change, but we're going to segue a little bit in our main direction here at EVTV. That doesn't mean the build stop, and in fact, we have update on the Cadillac Escalade EXT. Let's take a look and see what Bill and Mark Butterite of Impatient Creations has worked out, and where they're at on that build.
Well, Bill says you're live.
All right, and we are live. Good morning. This is EVTV. I'm Bill Baer. It's the 24th of June, 2017. Sitting here with Mark Buckright. Buckright, have I got the right?
Buckright, yeah. Big mouthful, big old good German name.
Of Impatient Creations in Alabama. Alabama? Alabaster Alabama. Is that even a place?
Yeah, it is, believe it or not. But it's, I tell people it's just like the color. And I can brag about our zip code. It's like Bond, 35007, James Bond. Oh, it's our zip code. You know?
My wife is someone that just never forgets anything. She will never, ever forget that, I promise you. In fact, you had an opportunity to meet my wife. We'll get to that in a second. Yeah. Tell us about Mark Buckright and Impatient Creations, a little bit about what you do and all that stuff.
Well, I've been with Impatient Creations probably counting about 15 years. Dennis Lyons, the owner, he and I go back probably some over 25 years now. He's just a hot rod, car building, loving sort of guy. We enjoy what we do. We've got I'm blessed to manage Impatient Creations, which we've got about 18,000 square feet. And it's much like the TV shows that you see. It's a big retro ride shop.
Kind of like Foose, Chip Foose and all that.
Yeah, that man's got a lot of talent. And and so we have to accumulate a lot of talent, you know, like that. And we're broken up into different departments within the company. But we work on probably about 30 to sometimes 40 cars at a time.
Really? Wow. Yeah. Doing like custom hot rods or restorations or what?
Yes, custom hot rods, restoration, just repairs. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of times you can come into the shop on any given day of the week, and we might have a couple old 65 style Mustangs.
Oh, nice.
68, 69 Camaros are pretty hot. Yeah. Chevy pickup trucks, that's a pretty good and trendy car. And then a lot of times, too, we'll have a lot of custom build type vehicles in, and we got some pretty unusual projects.
And one unusual project, most recently, my wife was actually down in southern Alabama. Might as well call it Florida, really. It's only about that far away. She was down there visiting family, and on her trip back up, she was driving along and for whatever reason pulled over, happened to look at her exhaust on the back of her little CRV and noticed that it was kind of at the wrong angle.
Yeah, it was pointed broken. Skyward, making all college type noises. Noise. Yeah.
Of course, she had the radio blasted up listening to New Kids on the Block, so she didn't hear it. But so she pulled over and she gives me a call.
New Kids, really?
Yeah, NKOTB. Oh, yeah, she's a big fan. She got a shirt. And so she didn't hear it, so she calls me in with a picture, and I'm like, well, that's no good. Well, I guess take it to a shop. Where are you? She's like, well, I'm in Alabaster, Alabama. And I remember I just talked to you like 2 hours earlier. I'm like, Alabaster. And I picked up your card. I'm like, are you anywhere near the address? And she's like, I'm like 2 minutes from that. Mm-hmm. Go over there, find Mark Buckright, tell her who I am, and see if he can help you out, or at least point you to someone who can. And
that was certainly a blessing for her.
It was ridiculous.
So we were glad to help. We got her pulled in the shop real quick and welded up her exhaust, got it all straightened out where she can make the trip home safely.
That was wonderful. It was fantastic. We really appreciate you helping us out.
Yeah,
like that.
You're welcome. Cool.
Welcome. That's one of your unusual projects.
I've got a wife and three beautiful girls, and they're traveling all the time. Got two of them are in college, so they're on the road, and so I'm always glad to lend a hand to someone.
Well, I guess to put on your list of odd creations sort of segues into, what are you doing in Southeast Missouri, Cape Girardeau? Why are you here right now?
Goodness, I don't know. I think I'm going to get bit by this electrical EV bug.
Really? You want to kind of go into that market, do you?
I find it very interesting. With a lot of the cars that we do, we've got access to some of the Tesla and i8 type cars, and have the pleasure of driving those. And oh my goodness, you talk about torque monsters, and it's a lot different from the gas end.
It pulls different.
Yes, it does. Yeah. So
we actually took a little ride in the Doka.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Going.
What do you think about that?
Boy, that'll put you back in the seat.
Yeah. So, what I typically do is I'm gonna give it away, so anybody comes and visits, you're gonna know what's gonna happen now, so it'll take the surprise away. But I'll just kind of go down the street and we'll talk about how nice it is and how quiet and smooth and everything, and we'll go over on sort of the highway through town there, and I'll just kind of pull out a little bit and then sort of punch it, and the person who's riding doesn't expect that to happen. They end up flying into the back seat usually, and just laughing at it.
Have to get the handle up there.
There's the whole Doka, the whole
strap
front
them
end.
On say, well, why are you doing this? Just wait and see.
The whole front end of the thing lifts up. It feels like you're gonna pop a wheelie, and it'll catch you by surprise. And yeah, that's pretty good though, huh? Yeah. Definitely not the original, four-cylinder.
No. I mean, I grew up working a lot of the old air-cooled, classics and stuff, and drive that, or take a ride in that little Donka. That's cool.
Something else. So you're going to take the Escalade off of our hands, is that right?
Yes, we are.
Yeah.
We've worked all morning here.
Got that thing loaded up.
Yeah. So, yeah, our plans are to take that and mount that Tesla drive unit in the back.
Yeah, we're going to take the rear axle off and the drive shaft and all that stuff.
Yep, yep, get all rid of all the unnecessary items.
And, yep, come up with some kind of suspension for it. And once you got that all sorted out, we're going to try something else too, huh?
Yeah, we're going to take a look at that Tesla battery pack, see if there's some way to mount that unit in entirety. But and then, you know, just initial looks of that, it seems to be quite a challenge. That unit is larger and
it's a big piece. We, as you know, we've gone into the solar stuff, and we've been using the Tesla modules, the individual modules. They're about 21, 23 volts each, and you string them all together, you end up with a very good-sized 48-volt pack, which is sort of a typical voltage of a solar system. So we've been taking the individual modules out of one of the battery packs. So we gave him the empty case, kind of make it a little bit
thanks
easier.
Thanks goodness. That way I don't have to have, you know, I'd hate to go home and, hey, guys, I got a new project for you. I'm going to have 10 of you lay on the floor. I'm going to put this Tesla battery pack, and you're going to stand there like little monkeys and hold it up. You
know? Yeah. The whole,
they wouldn't like me very long.
The whole entire case with battery modules in it is about 1,500 pounds.
Wow, that's
without
a lot.
Without it, the two of us can lift it and slide it along a trailer pretty easy. So it's a big plus to have that empty case for you. The drive unit itself is really heavy. And that's why that's going to be a challenge on you, but I think you're up to it.
You know, in the hot rod world, we would chrome all the suspension and polish it up.
Yeah.
You know, maybe we need to do that.
All right. Well, we'll put it on the list of things to do. So, let's see. What else? Anything else? Can you think of anything else? I can't think of anything else. You got anything else to add to this?
No, like I said, I think this will be a different and unusual project. Mm-hmm. And for any of those that, you know, have a curiosity, like I said, you can look us up at impatientcreations.com. We do about 250 cars a year between repair and maintenance and painting and different things.
Well, maybe we'll put a little screenshot on the screen behind us and
so
a little banner right about there.
And we'll get this thing mounted, get some photographs taken, and you know, go on the website. And I'm
excellent.
Sure yours too.
That's great. Yeah, take lots of pictures
together.
For us.
We will.
Do that. Okay. Well, Mark.
All right.
Is it great to meet you?
Likewise, Bill.
Glad to have you here.
It's been a fun morning.
For sure.
Jack wasn't here, but I heard he's going off to the Ozarks.
Yeah, he's going down to Branson with family. They're jumping in the car. I think they're taking the gas burner actually.
Yeah. Oh man.
Yikes. But yeah, they're going to drive down to Branson. I think they're spending the whole week down there. It's going to be kind of a sort of a mini family reunion. I think Jack's actually going to run off with the 4-year-old and the 2-year-old and leave Jill to take care of all the
there
other
you
kids.
Go.
But
well, that sounds like a lot of fun. So we just wish him a good, you know, weekend. And
well, there you go.
So
alrighty, stay with us.
Okay, over here, we've got a drive unit itself that Bill's been polishing up. A little mother's polish, and that's shining up very nicely. He has also split the case of the gearbox, installed the Quaife ATB, and has put it back together and filled it with automatic transmission fluid. And we will hook this up to our test bench here, and which is looking like kind of a mess these days. There's our other clip, that's our bench clip. And but we will test this one and make sure it still turns. Of course, we tested it as a sub clip, but we're gonna test it again and get that going before we reinstall it in a sub clip. And then we'll have it ready Friday for him to take with the
S. Okay.
As it turns out, Mark Butkerite is coming from Impatient Creations in Alabaster, Alabama, on Friday. Pick up a full subclip to put in the Cadillac Escalade. And here we've got one torn down. Now the reason for this is, of course, we have to install the Quaife automatic torque biasing differential. That's really the secret to those burnouts of a recent video, is because we've got a continuously torque biasing differential instead of the eaten open differential in the Tesla Model S. But to do that, we had to remove the drive unit from the subclip and split it and install the quafe, and then we'll have to put it back in. But this is the stripped down subclip that we're trying to clean up for installation in the Cadillac Escalade, and we'll load this on his pickup truck. I'll let him take it to Alabaster, Alabama. Over here, we've removed the rotors and run them through the bead blaster, and so they're looking quite a bit cleaner. They were some rusty looking hunks, but here they are in all their glory, and we'll reassemble that as well. And yes, he got them inside and out with the bead blaster, and so we'll have shiny new rotors on our subclip. Yeah.
It's impatient.
Mm-hmm. All right, so here we've got our device. Bill has installed the drive unit back in the subclip. We've reassembled the rotors back on the unit. Dylan has put on the electronic parking brake assemblies. There is our electronic parking brake controller. So we'll have electronic parking brakes on the Escalade. That will be cool. While we were working on this, Bill Bayer's wife, who is from Alabama, called. She was returning from her home in Alabama and had her muffler blow out. And he asked her where she was at, and her story was she was in Alabaster, Alabama. And he said, how far are you from this address at Impatient Creations? She said, they're 2 minutes from here. So he said, well, go over there and see what they can do about your muffler. They may know somebody. And so she took her car over there, and they actually welded it back together for her and put her back on the road. And so Mark Butgerite from Impatient Creations will be here tomorrow to pick up the Escalade. And this is the drive unit we have prepared for him to put in the 2008 Cadillac Escalade. And that shined up pretty good, cleaned up pretty good. And we have tested it, and it's fully operational. Mr. Butgerite of Impatient Creations has offered the expert opinion that he can get a Tesla Model S battery, a whole one, mounted securely under the Tesla Model S. And I have offered the counter observation that if he could do that and make it work, I'd pay him for it. Thing is, he needs a battery. Actually, he doesn't need a battery. This battery is 1,330 pounds as a battery. It's only a couple hundred pounds, maybe 230, as an aluminum chassis. And that's really what we need to fit to the car. So we found the hump, bolted that back in place, and removed the center section that has the wiring in it I want to take a look at. And the BMS board, the contactors, and we cut off all the little fittings to do the cooling. We're going to play with those and let Mr. Butgerite figure out how to mount this frame to the Escalade Model S. Should he succeed, then when we get the truck back, we will drop this and bolt the Y battery in its place. And down here we'll have connections to the battery and thence to our full battery controller and the vehicle. So we've got a shot. Several viewers had suggested that we make an attempt of this to make the full battery pack work with the Escalade. I sure like them all up in the bed where I can get to them easy, but they're probably correct. The vehicle would drive better with this down low and between the wheels. There is sufficient dimension to do that, and we'll see what Mr. Buckwright can come up with as far as fabricating a mounting for it. But it looks quite doable. I'm going to send him a couple of shock absorbers. I don't think he's going to be able to use them, but he can look at them anyway. And so that's the update on the Escalade battery, is maybe we can fit this pan to the vehicle. And if we can do that, we can probably fit a full battery to the vehicle.
Yeah, Wait, back up. All right, come on down. There you go. Lift it up and tilt it forward. So there you go. Yeah, now slide in. All right, stop. That'll be short of the bed there. And yeah, should be able to pick up and tilt forward. That should do it.
That'll do
it. Yeah.
All right.
All right.
Okay, just checking.
You can edit.
Yeah, I figured.
It's easier to edit than add.
Yeah, I was going to say, take out the guy that drove by.
We need to do a post-production. Mark, could you come back? We need to do this real quick. This is fun.
Yeah. Blew it in my ear.
Oh.
Did I put it back in gear?
Yeah, probably.
The door will probably have to be closed. You may not be able to
we'll see.
You might have to sit in, but once we get up, I think the front door will open.
Market Inpatient Creations. We're here today coupled with EVTV, which you all know is Jack from EVTV. We're working on his 2008 Escalade, and we're going to be doing some work with him on transplanting his Tesla drivetrain into his Escalade. So Jack, I believe back in 2012 already has done electric conversion where they took the original engine out and coupled it with a couple of DC drive motors to the transmission. And over the years, not only being DC and lower power, but you know, he's had a lot of problems with the transmission. So Jack and I have been talking over the last several months, and he's been successfully getting these Tesla drive units. And pictured here on the floor is the whole Tesla driveline carriage. You've got your Tesla electric motor here, your inverter. You've got your basically your suspension cage and carriage assembly with all your suspension. Comes complete with a driveline axle. Jack has gotten with, I believe, Quaife, and there you're actually putting a limited slip differential in these units. So they take these apart and put that in there, and that'll get us power to both wheels on the ground at the same time, which in the hot rod world, that's really something. And also pictured here, just in front of this, is a couple of the Tesla coilover struts and airbag shocks. As we get further into the project, we'll see if we can make use of some of those units. And this is the vehicle right here that's pictured on the left. And what we're going to be doing is we'll get this get it up on the lift. We'll remove the rear end. Look what it's going to take to fabricate special mounts and get the driveline unit and everything attached to the vehicle. And we're working on this up here at the Inpatient Creation Shop, which we do a lot of different types of conversions. This is actually a 48 Buick Roadmaster. That what we've done is taken the original driveline. It had a crankshaft or a throw rod on the original engine, and the owner bought it at an auction, so we put a 350 engine. Chevrolet engine and transmission in. We modernized all the wiring harness, the braking system, put power steering on it, and this will be finishing up here in the next week or so and be shipped to Virginia. One of the other little neat projects some of you might like, you older guys, you know what Willis Jeeps are. It's a 52 Willis Jeep, and this customer brought us all his various parts and pieces, and we've gone through and taking the entire vehicle apart, painted the frame, rebuilt all the driveline axles, going through the engine transmission type stuff, painted the whole body, and we're going through the assembly phases now, and we've gotten it up and running. We got all the electrical hooked up, and we should be having it on the ground this next week, running and driving for the customer. One of the other projects that we've got is a 68 Mustang Fastback, and we've got a basically 2000 Lincoln engine transmission retrofit. A lot of them now on the four guys, you might call these as the single overhead cam mod motors. But those are pretty popular, and fitting those in a lot of Mustangs and other Ford drive lines. Right here, we've got this car in. This customer brought this car in from Nevada, and it's a 72 Lincoln that's sat up for a long time. So we're getting that up and running, and we're going to be taking a lot of components off the engine and detailing it, and going through and getting all the electrical stuff working and windows. This is a 52 NGTD, and it's a little kit car. And the guy just wasn't very reliable, had a little four-cylinder Ford, and it kept blowing up or leaking or doing something. So he brought it into us and asked if we could put a different driveline in. So we chose basically a 97 Mazda Miata 1.8 liter engine. So we put the old engine and transmission in. We've gotten all the exhaust routed, got a custom aluminum radiator built for it. And right now what we're doing is just trying to get the intake manifold. It goes beyond the side panels here, so we've cut the intake, and we're getting ready to weld and extend the intake runner tube so that we can get the intake system going. Right here behind me, this is a full build. It's a 68 Camaro, where we've done the new Camaro green. We've just got an LS swap in it, where we go through and put a new LS engine and automatic transmission in, and we update all the wiring harness and make it a reliable everyday car. So this is going through there. And here you can take a peek of Jack's car again. Like I said, he's got a real nice ride here, all factory interior. And you can see here, we've done a couple of conversion items from the electrical drive line. And we'll be going through as it progresses. And like I said, we'll be taking Jack's original wheels. We've got some specialty wheel adapters machine that we can bolt his 6-bolt wheels to the 5-bolt wheels on the Tesla drive unit. So, look for some clips coming up later in the week or as we go, and we'll be showing you some clips of the driveline. Again, this is Mark at Impatient Creations coupled with EVTV, and we're signing off, and I wish you guys... Hey guys, this is Mark at Impatient Creations again, along with EVTV, and we're talking about the 2000 Escalade Tesla transplant. Here we got the Escalade up on the lift. And we're going to be going through and pulling and cleaning up this drive line. We're going to take the dual drive electric motors out, the transmission and four-wheel drive transfer case. We're going to go through and take out all this drive shaft. And then back here you can see the rear end setup. All this will be removing to make way for the new Tesla driveline unit. And we've got the unit here on the floor, and kind of gives you a little bit of an idea of the difference between the two and some of the mounts and the things that we're going to have to work through. But anyway, this is an update for EVTV and Impatient Creations. See you later.
Mark, what are you doing?
Hey guys, it's Mark at Impatient Creations and EVTV. We're here to talk about the 2008 Tesla Escalade project, and we're heading up this program and really got you tuned up. But some of the things that we're going to be covering today is how we're doing the layout of this Tesla conversion. Now in the last segment, if you saw the video clips, we were talking about the Tesla unit, about some of the different variances. But here we'll get a little bit more in depth on how we're trying to actually set it up. One of the things that we're going to go through is we've got the drive line here, and we basically set this on a lift table. Now for you guys and home mechanics, this would be a really good thing for y'all to buy at Harbor Freight or some of the industrial places, because it's got a high lift capacity. It's easy to raise and lower at the end. You can weld to it, you can drill, and you can bolt to it. But with this right now, we've got the Tesla set up, and there's this bar that we run basically underneath, and we're picking some of the flat spots under the unit. And what this bar will allow us to do is keep the suspension in a fixed position. Overall, most cars are designed to have the drive line with your drive axles in a level at ride height. So what we've gone through is we've got the unit resting. We welded a couple little pieces here, not directly to the Tesla unit, but just by spacing on flat spot, it locks it in. We've come along here and it's just resting on the bolt. And there's one place where we've actually welded a tab and we've drilled and just tapped a small hole in the suspension arm so that if we have the weight of the tire, it won't move up and down. This allows us to take measurements from a level plane on the Tesla unit up to the chassis. We can run a level horizontally or vertically or square things off from there. Now the other thing you may notice that we've actually got the Escalade tire mounted on it. We've gone ahead and put the wheel adapter on this side, which is a two-piece component. If we go over to this other side, you can see more of how this adapter works. Now on these adapter designs, what you have to do is actually go through and cut off the wheel studs. You'll see one of these here that we left at the factory length. And the key thing about setting this up is you got to make sure that all the surfaces are perfectly flat. You'll notice a little star bolt there. If you were to run a flat edge over, a lot of times they protrude and there's no, it would make an unlevel surface. So you may need to go through and sand that. An easy way to mark your studs is you can come through and take a piece of tape like this and either hold the adapter or the thickness. Run your tape on the edge like this right here. And you remove the adapter, you cut the wheel stud off. And then what you need to do is just carefully sand it to make sure that this wheel stud does not protrude below the flat surface. Once that's installed, then you can go through and bolt your other adapter on top of this unit. And the reason for that, if these wheel studs are sticking through, it's going to give you a soft mount, which is putting pressure on this, and you can't properly torque it, which is very dangerous in this high torque application. Now the other thing you need to follow the manufacturer's wheel specs as far as torques. Just look up on the Tesla driveline and torque your lug nuts there, and the same thing for the Escalade. Now a lot of times through the manufacturing process, these wheel studs, when you get them in, they're pressed in with a press, but often that might be a few degrees off in the direction. So what's a good idea is to take your wheel right here. Go ahead and fit it into the back side of your wheel. Go ahead and run all your lug nuts on it and then torque them all down. And what that will do, is in case one is a little bit off a direction or so, it'll torque the plate and straighten all the wheel studs on, which will make your installation easier. So by doing that, that'll help a lot of your headaches and setup procedure. And then, you know, once that's done, you can take this, bolt it onto your adapter. Now these are really nice pieces here. They've got some lineup pins that they use throughout the machining process. You can see the concentric inner and outer diameter between the adapters, and all of that is done for safety. And that all bolts together. And then you've got another set of these taper bolts in that lock your wheel adapters together. So then when you're through, you go through and torque all those down. And one of the other things that we're working on, we've already had this unit up into the, or positioned underneath the car, and so we're working on the preliminary mounts. Now with the Tesla, you have four of these rubber isolator type bushings, and sits basically we're going to go through and try and fab the mounts by placing it in position. So one of the things that we're doing in prepping for this is we're just using a thick flat bar. This is approximately 1/4 inch. We're cutting everything a little bit long now. You can see here, this is a 5/8 bolt, and then you use a grade 8 type bolt, and it'll go through. We weld the nuts on here because our plan is that this will be a welded nut plate. And then what we'll do is when we have this in position, we're using it's about a 2.5 inch square tube, 1/4 inch wall, and our hopes are that once this is in the chassis, we can move this around once the unit's centered, tack weld everything, cut this to height once we got the unit established, and then we can come back and trim the plate as necessary. So the other thing, if you take a look over here underneath the vehicle, some of the prep stuff that we've done, after we remove the rear drive axle, This is one of the original mounting points. And this right here, if you try and set the Tesla unit up in the vehicle, obviously it sticks down pretty far and it protrudes. So we use just your everyday Sawzall and cut that off on this type of steel. That's, you know, a good tool to have. We can go later then and grind and dress all the mounts and remove everything else that's not necessary. We've removed the bump stops where the axle used to, there's the bump stops for the axle. Some of the other things we've just gone through and removed any unnecessary items such as charcoal canisters, some of the other muffler mounts and so forth. But as in the next phase, we're actually going to reposition the unit in here. We took some axle centerline measurements from the suspension where the axle was originally located, and that in conjunction with the overall height that we want to set this up, we'll get everything positioned and square it all up, and with the lift table, raise it up and down, and then we'll start taking measurements for our mounts. Now hopefully for you guys that are, you know, self-builders or anything else, that might give you a few ideas, some things to think about. This is a scenario where basically it's just a reality fit. But anyway, you guys, hopefully this is helpful to you, and we'll talk to you guys later at EVTV. And this is Mark from Impatient Creations, where high performance meets high performance.
That is coming along in a promising fashion. I'm glad to see that part of the work go to Alabama instead of my shop. The mechanics of fabricating that conversion from a standard rear end to a independent rear suspension and the Tesla drive unit maybe out past my pay grade. That's got to be in there straight, it's got to be in there true, and it has to operate as designed in a completely different vehicle. And that should be a challenge, but this Impatient Creations, as you saw, seems to take on a variety of projects and complete them successfully. So I think we're in good hands. Let's talk a little bit about solar. I've got solar on my mind these days. And if everybody's going to drive electric vehicles, Jack needs something to do with his day. September 2016, South Australia was hit with a thunderstorm that knocked out supply from the state's transmission network, leaving an area four times the size of the United Kingdom in the dark and without electrical power for several days. This is a sparsely settled area of the world, but the people that do live there have to have their binge watch of Game of Thrones just like the rest of us. And they were pissed. Meanwhile, Elon Musk offered a solution and noted on Twitter that he could put them in a 100 megawatt battery in 100 days. Australian entrepreneur and the co-founder of Atlassian, Mike Cannon Brooks, contacted him on the bet and asked him if he was serious. And Elon Musk doubled down on it and said, yeah, he would, if he didn't have it in operation 100 days from contract signing, he would give it to them for free. And Mr. Cannon Brooks pulled together the political politicos and the utility company guys and the money and called him on the bet. And so Tesla has received a contract to provide a battery that can produce 100 megawatts of power and provide 129 megawatts of storage in Jamestown, South Australia, within 100 days. And the battery will be charged using energy from the nearby Hornsdale wind farm and will deliver energy during peak usage hours to help maintain supply across the state. This 129 megawatt battery is the equivalent of 1,518 Tesla Model S's, so no big deal. Why would Elon make such a risky bet? Well, in the first place, he kind of has control of what date he signs the contract. And it's from that date to 100 days that he has to have this up and running. He's done it once before, really twice before, once in Southern California, once in Hawaii, on really kind of similar bets. And in fact, as a warm-up, installed an entire solar system for a South Pacific island. Why would he want to do this? Well, Elon Musk has the biggest battery factory in the world now, the Gigafactory. And he wants to sell solar batteries to every home in America. Now, what would the bragging rights be to having the largest utility-grade battery installation in the world? How much would he pay to get to do that? Well, apparently the full price if he has to. But if he can deliver it in 100 days, he'll actually make a profit on it. And so it was kind of a sure bet, which is the kind entrepreneurs really like the best. They're known as risk takers, and they like to appear to take risks without actually taking much in the way of a risk. So I think this is a great idea. I've been looking at our solar usage. Here at EVTV, we have a 24 kilowatt bank of 8,300 watt Rent-A-Solar 15.5% panels that are grid tied. And we, if we make excess energy, we're metered to go back into the grid, and we take it back out when we need it. If there was any overage, we would get paid a magnificent 1.75 cents per kilowatt hour for the same power they charge us 10 cents a kilowatt hour with, although with taxes it's 12. Most peaker plants, usually natural gas turbines, get a relatively huge premium over the retail price of electricity to provide theirs, which is why they're profitable to build. But in dealing with us low-life solar people, the utility companies have come up with a concept called avoided cost. Avoided cost of the power, which is basically a function of the cost of coal per ton. And it's entirely theoretical, but they managed to get it passed through the state legislatures and public regulatory officials, which they pay so handsomely to make these determinations. But that, I'm wandering. Back to our system, you have to actually measure output. Sunlight's a very variable thing. Comes up in the morning, as most of you know, and goes down at night, and varies in intensity by angle. And so you might have full sun in the early morning, but it's not fully on your panels. And this similarly in the evening, you have clouds, birds flying over, birds shitting on the panels. There's a lot of variables. It varies minute by minute, hour by hour, and day by day through the seasons. You have a much shorter solar day in December and January and February, but at cooler temperatures, your panels work a little bit more efficiently. So it's a pretty complex system. Solar installers and people who are solar enthusiasts tend to sit around with a four-function calculator and imagine themselves into immense riches and beneficence of the sun. Reality is what you actually experience. And in fact, 1 year's worth of data is not normally enough. But I took 2016. Our peak month was June, where we generated 112.9 kilowatt hours per day during the course of that month. 3,387 kilowatt hours for the month. And that's using a 24 kilowatt array. But our nadir region was December, 41.37 kilowatt hours per day with a total of 1,241 kilowatts. Why is that important? That gives us an average for the year of 83.33 kilowatt hours per day. And if we take that and divide our 24 kilowatt array into the 83,333 watts we generate on average in a day, I get a true average solar day of 3.47 hours. Now, why is that important? Well, if you're selling solar installations in Missouri, you tell everybody it's somewhere between 4 and 4.5 hours a day. If you take all the incident light falling on the panel during the entire day, it would add up to a certain number of hours of full theoretical 1,000 watt per square meter of solar insolence. And so in some regions of the country, they say it's 4 hours. Others, it's 4.5 hours or 5 hours. And that's averaged over the course of the year. Here in Missouri, my actual experience, and understand, I can measure the peak output of the panels at midday. And so I know that my panels are operating within advertised specification. But the result is that our experience during 2016 was 3.47 solar hours per day. And why do I want that number? Well, in sizing other solar systems or other possible applications here at EVTV, I can use that figure. If I put in a 10K array, it's going to have 3.47 solar hours per day on average, just like the other part of the roof. And so we could figure it for 34.7 kilowatt hours that day as a 10 kilowatt array. 50 kilowatt array would then be 150 and change. And so we can use this concept of a solar day, the total radiation falling on the panels that's usable to convert it into electricity, best when we generate it from historical data at the same location and the same weather. Now, 2015 was a little different, and 2017 shaping up as being different yet, but if I did this over 10 years, I'd have a very accurate picture of what we can assume for an average solar day, but I bet it wouldn't vary a whole lot from this. I bet we'll be somewhere around 3.5 hours per day, and so I can use that. The last 2 weeks, Dylan, I have a page in the printer. If you would bring it to me, it might help me. The last 2 weeks, I have been in a battle royale with our Tesla battery controller. And the interesting thing about that is it controls the battery just fine. And we can close contactors, and we can open contactors, and we can monitor individual cell voltages, thank you. And we can monitor currents, and we can monitor temperatures, and we can do it all using the BMS boards that are on the Tesla modules. We're about to embark on a big NEMA 36 by 30 inch, 12 inch deep cabinet with 6 Tesla modules and all the components built into the cabinet to make a very ruggedized 30 kilowatt hour battery pack. And we can do all sorts of things with that going forward, including data logging and perhaps Bluetooth interface to Apple iPhones and so forth. So it's an exciting thing, but one of the things we need to do is be able to operate with some of the other equipment. Joe Sidebottom down in Florida with a company called Coronado Solar, a solar installation company that does a lot of work in the islands, and he lives off grid entirely. In fact, he's got a little community where three or four of his buddies and him all have ground in the same area, and they all build houses, and they're all going to be off-grid. And he sees a lot of future in Tesla batteries as solar storage. I do too, but I was initially a little bit alarmed at the naivete, shall we say, in the solar community about these batteries. I love lithium batteries. They do have some safety issues beyond lead acid and valve regulated and glass mat absorbed glass mat batteries. And we're pretty accustomed to that with the lithium iron phosphate cells. The Tesla cells offer a huge opportunity and at the same time a huge safety issue. By way of example, Tesla is going to sell a Powerwall. This is an all-in-one device that will be all things to all people with a 10 kilowatt hour backup battery pack in it for $11,000 and almost $12,000. By contrast, you can commonly purchase an entire Tesla 85 kilowatt hour battery pack for $15,000 or less. There are people that are buying those and taking them apart and selling the modules at about $1,350 each. And in doing so, they're actually making $4,000 or $5,000 per pack for the act of taking them apart, which does take an hour, but is doable. And so the Tesla batteries for, let's say, the same $11,800 gives about 8.5 times the storage as Tesla's Powerwall. And they're much cheaper than any batteries that we can sell you from China. And so we're seeing these batteries go into electric vehicles across the land, but more importantly and more commonly, they're being snapped up for solar installations. The lithium cobalt, lithium nickel cobalt, manganese oxide, aluminum oxide chemistry in the cathode of these cells is what enables them to have such high energy density and high power output. It's also what makes them quite unstable. And so they're actually quite dangerous. And if you overcharge them or over-discharge them, and the usual scenario is to first over-discharge them to where a couple of cells are damaged, and then using a normal charge of the pack, you overcharge those cells. Then they go into thermal runaway and take the rest of the pack with them fairly quickly. I was actually privileged to witness, although not film, this exact process in real time right here at EVTV. Now, that was with a somewhat milder battery, the Nissan Leaf lithium manganese oxide spinel cathode. Same voltages as the Tesla cells. Not stable, but perhaps not as hot as what's in a Tesla. And so I am very excited about the opportunity to use salvaged electric vehicle batteries in solar applications. and somewhat alarmed at the manner in which people are doing so, particularly doing it in their house while they're sleeping. And so it's we have taken on the task of using the very capable battery management system boards that come on each Tesla module and developing a controller that can communicate with them and get the temperatures and the cell voltages and allow you to set limits as to how much the cells can vary, what the highest voltage you'll allow per cell, lowest voltage you'll allow per cell, the voltage at which you will begin charging as it decreases in state of charge, and the state of charge level and voltage where you will cut off charging in order to operate the batteries. And that's going very well. Joe Sidebottom with Coronado Solar asked specifically that we make this interoperate with his inverter of choice, the Sunny Island 6048-US. This is a very interesting charger. It is probably the darling of off-grid. I'm told it outsells Outback even, Outback Radian series, which I had assumed was the 800-pound gorilla in the space. But Joe assures me that there's a lot more Sunny Islands out there than Outbacks. They put out 120 volts AC at about 5.7 kilowatts. And so I've got a couple things against them right away. I like inverters to put out 240. These are typically for larger systems, and you simply use two or four to put out the power you need. And by hooking a standard communication cable between them, you can make 248C using two of them from the same battery. So I looked at his spec for CAN, and as you know, I'm used to having reverse engineer CAN. Actually having a spec is usually a delight, and this had three or four messages that had to be sent for stuff we were already measuring, and I told him, sure, we'll put the CAN in there to work with the Sunny Island, no problem. So he arranged for me to purchase a Sunny Island at his installer price, which was attractive. These things are typically about $4,500 a piece. And we got it in, and I whipped up the code to support the CAN that it wanted on the CAN interface. I had some connection difficulties in physically connecting the Sunny Island to our box. But they were the usual old man Alzheimer foibles, coupled with an Ethernet cable that was a factory Ethernet cable with a bad Ethernet end connector on it. We're playing with the other end, and I'm thinking I've done something wrong. It's the factory end that was the problem. But we got it all together and got the Sunny Island making electricity, and it has the further ability to charge the batteries if you put AC power into it. And so we did, and it did nothing. And we went over all of our CAN again, and it seemed to be all correct. And so we started looking at the Sunny Island. The Sunny Island has, and I have counted them, 377 parameters. Some of which have as many as 14 options in a selection list for a single parameter. It notifies 82 events and has 202 different warnings and error messages, all of them with a numeric and then an impossible abbreviation. How can a device used to convert DC to AC becomes so hopelessly complex. And I just told him, I said, I'm done. I couldn't even guess. There's 72 trillion combinations of these 377 parameters, as best I can tell. And I just don't have time to go through all 72 trillion. So he attempted to help me by email, and actually he is very knowledgeable about these things. And in only 40 or 50 emails, we got this worked out, and it indeed began charging. But I was mystified by the complexity. And then I looked at our MPPT charge controller that I was very excited about, the Morningstar, which, unlike most of them, most of the MPPT chargers are a maximum of 48-volt battery output and typically limited to 100 or 150 volts on the PV side. Well, our strings on both sides are more like 460 to 480 volts. We'll have, they'll only put out 5 or 6 amps, but they'll be 400 or 460 volts. And, of course, we have multiple strings that come down from the roof, both on our experimental side and our regular side. That's the configuration. And most professional solar grid-tied systems that are bring down DC and convert it to AC, that's the way it's done. It lets you use much lighter cables, and you have a set for each string, but they're smaller, and you can route them more easily and deal with them. And they don't carry as much current per wire, but at a higher voltage. And we got this MPPT controller working real well with our battery charger controller. And by switching the photovoltaic 400 or 500 volts using a little gigavac minitactor to turn on and off the voltage to the device at all, and that gives us complete control of it being off and on. Unfortunately, this device somehow thinks it knows something about batteries, which was a sin replicated in the Sunny Island. A whole lot of information about different battery chemistries and some very complicated charge algorithms having to do with the bulk phase, where you put in most of the power using the maximum current, and the absorption phase, which for us would be constant voltage, where you hold a voltage and let the current trail off. But they also has a float phase, and that's where you simply keep the battery topped up with a very low current, and then an equalization phase where you raise it to a higher voltage for a fixed amount of time in the hopes that the batteries will boil off enough hydrogen and oxygen gas to equalize themselves and so maintain their ability to act as a battery. Hopelessly complicated by a variety of different cells. You've got the Edison iron cells, and you have the valve-regulated lead-acid cells, and the flooded lead-acid cells, and the absorbed glass mat cells, and each of them have different profiles for these four or five different charge stages. And all of this they try to account for in a piece of equipment that you only has three controls, up, down, and enter. You can't program a computer with an up and down arrow. That's very awkward. So we'd turn on the MPPT charge controller, but it would vary the amount of current that it put out, and its maximum is a smooth 60 amps. At 48 volts, which is plenty for what we're doing, but it would vary that from 60 down to 28, and then to 35, and then to 40 something, back down to 35, chasing this battery situation. So I asked Dylan, I said they have a custom configuration, but you have to get their software and plug it into the device and program it. Just program it to be on all the time. Highest voltage, highest current it will make. We'll control it with the contact. Well, the first thing was their software requires Windows. We don't do Windows well around here, but sometimes we're forced to do it. So we dug out an ancient XP laptop and got the software installed on it. And then I found out that Dylan comes back after talking to their product support that their Ethernet cable connection from the laptop to the MPPT charge controller requires a crossover Ethernet cable. Now, a few of you do know what that is. If you'll think back through the pages of ancient history, but since the advent of Hewlett-Packard's invention of automatic MDIX in 2001, we haven't had to deal with Ethernet crossover cables. Crossover cable is simply swaps the TX and the RX lines so you can hook two pieces of equipment that are normally the ends of the line to each other directly. But since automatic MDIX came out, all equipment that I know of has this feature, and you can hook up a crossover cable or not a crossover cable. You don't need a crossover cable. Any Ethernet cable will do. And it made that whole ridiculous problem go away. 15 years ago, it went away. Except this particular device, which just came on the market, somehow found a chipset somewhere that didn't support automatic MDIX. And so we have to use a crossover cable to do a custom definition of a battery that I'm like, why does this thing know about batteries anyway? So I've got two devices here, the inverter and the MPPT charge controller, that both very badly want to be a battery control system, and they want to do it very, very badly. And by that, I don't mean intensely, but very awkwardly. And the whole thing is a little bit bizarre to me. My relationship to electric vehicles from the beginning has been, it's all about the batteries, stupid. Nothing else in the car really matters. It's about the batteries, and it always has been. In solar, I profess that it's going to be the same way, and you'll find that surprising in that I would say 80 or 85% of the solar installations in the United States don't have any batteries at all. I installed, what was at the time, the first net metered home in the state of Colorado, and the largest residential photovoltaic array in the world, I was assured at the time in 1998, at a cost of over $275,000. I still own that home, by the way. My son lives there in Morrison, Colorado. And it did have a 50 kilowatt hour battery bank made up of Trojan lead acid batteries that were probably about $12,000 then. So I just said, with the advent of the electric vehicle, we can be into 85 kilowatt hours of lithium iron phosphate cells about the size of this table and about 4 inches thick for about the same money. The Trojans actually occupied the entire space underneath my rear deck of the house. I think it was a 2,400 square foot deck. It was big. I'm still about the batteries. I think that solar is not going to come into its own and actually take its proper place as the power for the future without the batteries. It's all about the batteries. And the batteries ought to be smart enough to control the charging, and the battery should know what it is, and these other devices shouldn't. Why 377 parameters? Well, if you look at all of the solar equipment, there is an inherent fatal flaw, a schizophrenia at the heart of it that has to do with connecting to the grid, the utility grid. And in this grand solar vision, we put excess power into the grid, we get our deficit power out of the grid, and we all share power in kind of a Pollyanna utopian world where everybody gets what they need by sort of sharing. I mean, I tear up thinking about this. But it's bullshit. Because at the other end of that cable is not your neighbor. It's not your friend. It's the utility company. And they are the next battle. For the internet, we had the telephone companies. For the EV, we had the oil companies, although they barely showed up for the war. They're so unconscious. It's over, and now they're waking up that there's a problem with electric vehicles. Sorry, guys. You missed the war and the closing V-Day celebration. And it's no time to bring it up now. But the utility companies have an army of consultants who are making an extremely good living right now with the utility companies paying them to come and explain to them how evil you solar installers are and how you spell the death of the business model of the great American monopoly utility companies. And they're doing some very devious things to try to stop you. And so a war is shaping up. But it goes down to the equipment, where if we lose the grid, we want to make power for our home, but we can't make power for our home because it's connected to the grid. And if it's connected to the grid, when the grid goes down, then the power is going out into a down grid that people might be working on. And as the utility companies repeat 76 times a day, someone might be working on that line and you would kill them. It's just a horrendous safety issue. My home in Colorado has a very old mechanical relay that's operated by the utility power. And if we lose it, it simply de-energizes, disconnecting the grid from my whole system. And I'm then powered by the system there. And you have to go out and manually turn it back on once the grid is established to get back on the grid. And it works perfectly. It's foolproof. There's no electronics. It's solenoids and relay arms. And you simply cannot be connected to the grid unless you have grid to power the relay. That won't work. Today we have anti-islanding and islanding and semi-islanding and so forth in the schizophrenic thing to try to deal with three basic modes. One is I'm making power from solar. Number two is I'm not, but I'm making it from batteries. And three is my batteries are down, I need power from the grid. And four is, I'm making too much power, I need to put it into the grid. And so the different scenarios at the same time, you have people installing solar systems that'll never see a grid. They're on a ranch in Wyoming. It would be $135,000 to extend a line out there. Nobody's going to be able to pay it just to get electricity. And a lot of people want off-grid homes out in the wilderness. And so you have entirely off-grid systems And then you have systems that simply are grid tied all the time. Don't have any battery backup, don't need any, don't want any. They just want to harvest from the sun. They make too much, put it in the grid, and when they need power, they get it from the grid. And so there's a lot of different installations all dealing with this grid thing. And mostly 85% of them have no batteries at all. And that's been the case. Going forward, I think it's all about the batteries, and I think you have to let the grid and the grid vision go. I'm going to put a diagram up here on the wall. I call this the selfish solar system. It's selfish in a lot of ways. I did a blog on this last week. It probably had more comments in a day than anything I put up in 5 years. It looks like an ordinary solar system, but it has some subtle differences that some of you will get, and they are actually revolutionary. And then it's just a change of thinking. You have to let it go. I call it the selfish solar system for one reason. Utility companies are extraordinarily selfish in this whole battle, and we're about to cut them out forever. Number two is that we have to be okay with the idea that we're going to make electricity for ourselves and the rest of the world, and most notably the grid, be damned. They just are not part of my life or any of my considerations in doing a solar design. I don't care about the grid, and I want a minimum amount to do with them that I can get away with, and I think I figured out a way to do that pretty well. The third way it's selfish is that the components quit trying to be all things to all people. With this hopelessly complicated configuration, largely driven by grid schizophrenia, but also with simply adopting roles in an attempt to be an all-in-one box, that doesn't make any sense. I have to tell you, I was very excited about Outback Power's announcement of their solar skybox, which is going to be everything in one box, just like the Tesla Powerwall. It's everything in one box. No sooner had I gotten used to the idea of the skybox than Midnight Power came out with an announcement of their B17 system. Google it. It's just too pretty. I have to have one, even though it doesn't make a lick of sense. I am going to have one. Probably put on the mail just to look at it. It's just gorgeous. And it's going to be hot swappable, and it's going to do stuff you didn't even know you wanted to do with solar. I mean, this thing will be able to make smoothies, juicers, you know. I mean, it can do anything. That's the problem. An inverter is a fairly simple device. It should convert DC to AC. That's it. It should be able to coordinate with itself and with others of its ilk to share power load and phasing, and to create 120 volts AC, 240 volts AC, three-phase power if you're in Europe, or whatever your local AC power needs are, because your home and all your appliances are AC. That's the only reason they exist as AC. If you go to buy a DC version of a refrigerator or a washing machine, it costs more than the AC version, which is more powerful. Simply because they don't make that many of them. We live in a world of AC air conditioners, AC refrigerators, AC fans, AC lights. That's what you're going to have to deliver. That's what an inverter should do. An MPPT charge controller, it shouldn't have to know anything about batteries. I know that's what they purport to be, as a battery charger. What they really are is a maximum power point tracker DC to DC converter to convert your rooftop photovoltaics to your battery voltage. And that input from the rooftop should be as wide as possible. to accommodate any kind of array that you might want, and the output should be again as wide as possible to charge your 12 volt battery or your 400 volt battery. And they should focus their efforts on that very real challenge of having that wide an input and efficiently converting power. If you want to have a brains of your system in a solar system, it should, of course, be the battery. The battery knows what kind of battery it is. It knows what its charge voltage is and what its discharge limitations are. And it should have a battery management system capable of communicating in various ways with an MPPT charge controller or an inverter. And so in order to maximize the use of EV components from wrecked cars, which are going to be so much cheaper, so over-engineered, let me give you an example. Our Tesla battery packs on a routine Model S can have to deliver as much as 1,100 or 1,200 amperes to produce 350 kilowatts to drive that motor at maximum power. In a house, a big house, 20 kilowatts is going to be peak. Now, I've already had people tell me, no, most houses today are 200 amp, 240 volts. 20 kilowatts won't even touch it. Yeah, well, go put a meter on it. That's the size of the pin you get from the hardware store to put in a house. It is called a 200 amp service because it has a 200 amp circuit breaker on it. Go see what you use. Most homes could be entirely powered by a single generator of 10, 12, or 15 kilowatts. If you got a 20 kilowatt generator, you're actually wasting fuel, because if all your air conditioners and all your refrigerators come on at the same time while you're cooking, you're not going to do 20 kilowatts. If you're charging three cars at the same time, okay, maybe get a 40 kilowatt inverter. The key to the selfish system is the 240 volts AC grid input up here. Actually, it's over there. And I propose using a normal 200 amp, 240 volt AC panel, an ordinary grid meter, and don't tell the utility company about shit. And what we're going to hook up to this is one device. And that's an EV battery charger. And truth to tell, a little charger from a Chevy Volt would do. It's kind of water cooled, which complicates it, but an Elcon charger. A Tesla Model S charger, if Jack would get back on task and complete that, would be ideal, except again, it has to be water cooled. And so you wind up with a little circulatory system there to handle that. But 10 kilowatts from a Tesla charger is more than you're ever going to need from the grid. And at that point, you have an 85 kilowatt Tesla battery pack. Average American home uses 31 kilowatt hours a day. We're close to 3 days of backup power here. If you need more, add a second battery pack. But the important crucial element here is two things. The battery controller has the brains of what the battery needs and will tell the MPPT charge controller and the 400 volt DC battery charger what to do, when to do it, and how much of it to do. And we can do that by can, or we can just do it by contactors and 12 volt signals from the battery controller. The other aspect is the inverter, and again, most of them want to work off a 48 volt battery. I have had to order a inverter from China, 20 kilowatts, that'll work off a 300 to 400 volt DC input and put out 240 volts AC. And I don't want a whole lot of variations on the theme. if 300 or 400 volts shows up here and I flip it on, it should make 240 volts AC, and it should do so without complaint up to 20 kilowatts continuously and some factor above that for a few seconds to start up an air conditioner or something, although 20 kilowatts, like I say, is more. We've already had made a CHAdeMO charge controller or charger that works off 300 to 400 volt DC bus. I've seen this coming for some time. We're eventually going to adopt EV voltages because the EV components are commonly available. And most of the CHAdeMO chargers want three-phase AC. Why not just have them work off the 400 volts DC? The 300 to 400 volt battery has another aspect to it that is technical, and I'll mention it. Many of you already know it. 120 volts AC is VAC RMS. RMS means root mean squared. The peak value of 120 volts AC is 1.414 times that number. And if you're charging capacitors out of a rectifier, that's the voltage they would charge to. If you have two of them 180 degrees out of phase for 240, that comes up to 340 volts, theoretically. As a practical matter, over and over, you're going to find it's 320. However, the conversion from this AC to DC and back to AC works a whole lot better and a whole lot more efficiently if we're talking about 300 to 400 volts DC and an AC that rectifies to 320 volts. Either direction you go. The reason we want to go to 300 to 400 volts is because that is the voltage that the EV industry has centered on, but it just happens to be almost ideal for dealing with our AC system. And so that's what I proposed, a 400 volt DC bus. Now, because the only connection to the grid is a battery charger, we're going to run off solar panels during the day, run off our batteries at night, and try to size this where it meets all of our needs. And we can do that incrementally by adding strings of 8 solar panels that put out 440 to 480 volts DC. That can be stepped down to our bus voltage. And if we're not making enough AC power, our DC power, to keep our batteries charged and power our home, add another string. And if you go beyond the limits of your MPPT charge controller, and I've had one of those made in China that will do 37 kilowatts, 100 amps at 400 volts, near enough, off of, again, 300 to 400 volt, or 400 to 500 volt PV input, you can add a second one of those. But the concept here is these are modular components you can add and swap in at will without 377 configuration parameters that are simple devices, and they're very selfish. They only do what they do. They only care about what they care about. They're not in charge of everything else, much less the schizophrenia of the grid. And so they're selfish devices to make a selfish system that just makes power for us to deal with a very selfish utility company that wants to own you. And our interface to the utility grid will be one panel that runs one device, a battery charger. And if they decide that that's not in their interest and that we should really pay $150 monthly minimum to even be connected to the grid, we can disconnect from the grid and we can plug a standard diesel generator, natural gas generator, right into the same panel. And the battery can't tell, and the battery charger can't tell, because they're selfish. They don't worry about what other things are doing. They just look for 240 volts AC coming in from the grid. And so that's the selfish solar system What else can I say about that? The idea is to maximize and simplify the use of standard EV components to make a solar system, and where we have to do a specialized equipment, it should be specialized to a single function. If you'll recall, Zenith introduced a piece of furniture that had a television set in it, a turntable, I believe a cassette player, but certainly the radio and power amplifier, all in one beautiful piece of 1957-ish blonde wood furniture. And I can tell you that I've seen these all over the world, and they make excellent furniture stands for a more modern TV, which is what they wound up doing. Magnavox had a competing device. These were all-in-one devices, and they were a great idea on the surface. But what we migrated to was modular systems, and everybody pretty much worked out to hook the turntable into the jack that said Phono, and that aux 1 and aux 2 could be used for something else, like a TEAC reel-to-reel, and that the power amplifier was really the brains of the system, the battery. And you could have a radio receiver, and people would, and these would be scattered all across bookshelves. Someday, you can reduce all of that to an iPhone and maybe an external speaker that's connected by Bluetooth. That's 30 years in the future as far as solar goes. Right now, we're moving away from the Zenith console and into a modular system that can be done inexpensively at much higher powers than people have talked about doing, so you can have a no compromises home. And as you grow it, you can use power from the grid, 3 kilowatts out of this charger, 24 hours a day is 75 kilowatt hours. A 10-kilowatt charger off of this thing would be 240 kilowatt hours. Ye gods, man, how much power do you need? In truth, our objective here is to put it into the battery with the solar panels and take it out with the inverter and not have to need any. But you can augment with a single point of contact, one device hooked up to one panel, and the utility company can't tell what it is. It's going to be a perfect thing. You don't have to have a meter. You're not going to get paid for your electricity. This system here is about $52,000 without the CHAdeMO charger. Who's going to pay $52,000 to generate a few kilowatt hours a day at 1.75 cents? Why do you want to sell power to the grid? You don't owe them anything. So it's a selfish grid. And I think that's going to be the appropriate mode going forward. Those who ignore these words are in peril during the coming battles with the utility company. You're going to be part of the bodies strewn on the field. And there will be some, but it won't be me, and it's not going to be very many of my viewers. Because we win every time. I haven't lost one yet. You have an internet. The EV thing is happening. Solar is next. The mosquitoes are desperately pleased they didn't get my undivided attention. It's a close call, but I went solar. So that's what we're going to do going into the future. We're not going to discontinue electric cars. I love them. I drive them. And there's still things that we can do there to help you with your builds and doing, basically what we do is vintage cars, romance cars, unusual cars. And we can come up with components and repurposing them from the OEMs, and that'll work very well. But I see my future, most of the efforts going toward repurposing electric vehicle components, and primarily the batteries, to solar power purposes. And I think we're on the cusp, like I said about AI, I think we're just at the breaking point where solar is going to take off so hugely that it's going to astound and amaze, all in amazement across the land. And it is going to produce kind of a panic in the political and the utility class. And they're going to do some very ugly things in response to try to survive. All unnecessary. I can show them how to do that. But the Burlington Northern Railroad had all the engineers and aluminum they needed to make the DC-3 aircraft. They could have done it a lot better than Raymond and Don Douglas. They didn't, and there's a reason. AT&T could have done the internet with a pencil. They didn't, and there's a reason. And the utility companies are not going to reinvent a beautifully distributed, intelligent, smart grid that serves your purposes, which they could do with a pencil. They already have all the stuff in place to be the market maker, to track all the money in and out of every building in America, collect the taxes for the government, and make a handsome living doing so. Instead, they're making a constant choice driven by arrogance and hubris to become irrelevant and to sell off their office equipment and bucket trucks at 6 cents on the dollar, and I'll be there. I've always wanted a bucket truck. That's it for EVTV this week. Probably a longer show than I wanted to do, but I had some interesting things to cover. And I wanted to introduce Selfish Solar System. It just looks like a solar system. Start now. Think about it and you'll find that it's a dramatic change in direction. And you're going to have to make it if you want to be one of the winners in the coming battle. Stay with us.